92nd Street Y Online Media is made possible by the generous support of listeners like you. This program features poet Lawrence Ferlinghetti and was recorded April 16th, 2007, before a live audience at New York's 92nd Street Y.
Good evening, everyone. I'm Betsy Bonner, director of the 92nd Street Y Unterberg Poetry Center, and I'm delighted to welcome you to tonight's reading by Lawrence Ferlinghetti. Mr. Ferlinghetti will be introduced by Marie Ponceau. Marie Ponceau's first book of poetry, True Minds, was published in 1957 in the City Lights Poetry Series. Her other books include Admit Impediment, The Green Dark, The Birdcatcher, and, most recently, Springing, New and Selected Poems. Her books on writing are Beat Not the Poor Desk and The Common Sense, both co-authored with Rosemary Dean. She has translated the fables of La Fontaine and books for children. I'm also proud to mention that Marie has been a member of our writing program faculty for 16 years. But before Marie's introduction, we wanted to take a moment to remember Kurt Vonnegut, who was a dear friend to the Poetry Center for more than 35 years. Mr. Vonnegut first read from this stage in 1970 in an evening shared with Muriel Rukeyser. He last appeared in 2004 for a tribute to Thornton Wilder. Here now is a brief audio clip from a conversation between Mr. Vonnegut and John Leonard, which took place at the Poetry Center in the spring of 1990.
I would think that the major function of art would be to make people really like life more than they do. I think life, particularly in this country, I don't know much about other countries, but the feeling here is, I'm not a good athlete. I can't dance as well as I should. I'm not as nice looking and all that. And we dislike ourselves. And the basic impression we get from advertising is that we, in fact, are failures. It's greatly lacking in one way or another. And movies make us feel that, too. And so what the artist can do is to make people like life better than they do right now.
Thank you. And now, please welcome Marie Ponceau.
I'm not going to take a long time to introduce a person who needs no introduction. We just heard Kurt Vonnegut say what poetry is for. It's to make life better and to make us like life better. Certainly that's what Larry's poems do, from pictures of a gone world to America's one. They take a great arc out of the landscape and cross decades of adventures. One of the great features of his work is that it is political and it is personal. Very unusual for someone to do both of those, as if they were one thing, as if they came from one center. His work is very centered. The pleasure that he gives us comes, I think, from the fact that he stands very firmly, steadfast, at some kind of a center we never perceive, because his poems, although personal, are not private. They're not invasive. He stands at his center, and he looks out. He's a lookout. He's a transmitter. He is, in fact, a radiant poet. And here he is.
I'm really honored to be introduced by Marie Ponceau, whom I always considered a much finer poet and a much finer mind than myself. And I'll miss Kurt Vonnegut, even though I didn't know him personally. He was of my generation, the generation that came of age during World War II, and he really articulated our consciousness. Anyway, thanks for coming out through all the storms. It seems as if climate change is happening right here and now. Would someone please educate Mr. Bush? Is poetry increasingly irrelevant these days? I'm going to read some poems from before 9/11, mostly lyric, and then for the second half, some poems written after 2002. I have some requests from my old book, A Coney Island of the Mind. Goya in America, in Goya's greatest scenes, we seem to see the people of the world exactly at the moment when they first attain the title of suffering humanity. They writhe upon the page in a veritable rage of adversity, heaped up, groaning with babies and bayonets under cement skies in an abstract landscape of blasted trees, bent statues, bat's wings and beaks, slippery gibbets, cadavers and carnivorous cocks, and all the final hollering monsters of the imagination of disaster. They are so bloody real, it is as if they really still existed. And they do. Only the landscape has changed. They still arranged along the roads, plagued by legionnaires, false windmills, and demented roosters. We are the same people, only further from home. On freeways, 50 lanes wide, on a concrete continent spaced with bland billboards illustrating imbecile illusions of happiness. The scene shows fewer tumbrils but more spaced-out citizens in painted cars, and they have strange license plates and engines that devour America. These poems in Coney Island are just numbered. No titles. Number 9. See, it was like this. When we waltz into this place, a couple of far-out cats is doing an Aztec two-step. And I says, Dad, let's cut. But then this dame comes up behind me, see, and says, you and me could really exist. Wow, I says. Only the next day, she has bad teeth and really hates poetry. I still get a kick out of reading these old chestnuts. This is a Third Avenue L poem when it was still up. When I was going to Columbia Graduate School from the village, the penny candy store beyond the L is where I first fell in love with unreality. Jelly beans glowed in the semi-gloom of that September afternoon. A cat upon the counter moved among the licorice sticks and Tootsie Rolls and Oh Boy Gum. Outside, the leaves were falling as they died. A wind had blown away the sun, A girl ran in. Her hair was rainy. Her breasts were breathless in the little room. Outside, the leaves were falling, and they cried, "Too soon, too soon." Rather a pathetic image in there about breasts. It was a face which darkness could kill in an instant, a face as easily hurt by laughter or light. "We think differently at night. We think differently at night," she told me once, lying back languidly. And she would quote Cocteau. "I feel there is an angel in me," she'd say, "whom I am constantly shocking." Then she would smile and look away, light a cigarette for me, sigh and rise and stretch her sweet anatomy, let fall a stocking. This is a Spanish impressionist poet that seems to be more or less unknown in this country, even though he has a whole museum devoted to his work in Madrid. Sorolla. Sorolla's women in their picture hats, stretched upon his canvas beaches, beguiled the Spanish impressionists. And were they fraudulent pictures of the world, the way the light played on them, creating illusions of love? I cannot help but think that their reality was almost as real as my memory of today, when the last sun hung on the hills, and I heard the day falling, like the gulls that fell almost to land, while the last picnickers lay in love, in the blowing yellow broom, resisted and resisting, tearing themselves apart again, again, until the last hot hung climax, which could at last no longer be resisted, made them moan. And night's trees stood up. In hintertime, Praxiteles laid about him with a golden maul, striking into stone his alabaster ideals, uttering all the sculptor's lexicon in visible syllables. He cast bronze trees, petrified a chameleon on one, made stone doves fly. His calipers measured bridges and lovers, and certain other superhumans whom he caught upon their dusty way to death. They never reached it then. You can almost see their breath, their stone eyes staring through 3,000 years. Allay our fears of aging, although Praxiteles himself at 28 lay dead, for sculpture isn't for young men, as Constantin Brancusi at a later hour said. This is unpublished. United Flight 10. The lady on the TV screen reading the letter from her lover, and the skinny airline hostess with the very short skirts serving us goodies, and the voluptuary lady on the screen reading the letter from her lover, and the thin airline hostess pouring more wine, and the lady reading her letter and now smiling with a faraway look, and all the passengers on the plane, very somnolent and half oblivious to the real life love on the TV, and the loneliness of the smiling skinny lady hostess, and outside the dusk falling, and the plane falling through the skies to land in the land of the pursuit of happiness. Well, for the second part, the poems written since 2002, beginning with a prose book that I'm publishing this fall with my great publisher, New Directions, Poetry as Insurgent Art. And it's got various inscriptions to begin with. The woods of Arcady are dead, and over is their antique joy. Of all the world undreaming fed, great truth is now her painted toy. William Butler Yeats. What times are these, when to write a poem about love is almost a crime, because it contains so many silences about so many horrors. Bertolt Brecht. We apologize for the inconvenience, but this is a revolution. Subcomandante Marcos. This is the first page of the book, of the text. As I say, this is prose. I am signaling you through the flames. The North Pole is not where it used to be. Manifest destiny is no longer manifest. Civilization self-destructs. Nemesis knocking at the door. What are poets for in such an age? What is the use of poetry? The state of the world calls out for poetry to save it. If you would be a poet, create works capable of answering the challenge of these apocalyptic times, even if it means sounding apocalyptic. You are Whitman, you are Poe, you are Mark Twain, you are Emily Dickinson and Edna St. Vincent Millay. You are Neruda and Mayakovsky and Pasolini. You are an American or a non-American. You can conquer the conquerors with words. If you would be a poet, write living newspapers. Be a reporter from outer space, filing dispatches to some supreme managing editor who believes in full disclosure and has a low tolerance for bullshit. If you call yourself a poet, don't just sit there. Poetry is not a sedentary occupation, not a take your seat practice. Stand up and let them have it. Now to see whether poetry is irrelevant. History of the aeroplane. The Wright brothers said they thought they had invented something that could make peace on Earth. If the wrong brothers didn't get hold of it. When their wonderful flying machine took off at Kitty Hawk into the kingdom of birds. But the Parliament of Birds was freaked out by this man-made bird and flew to heaven. Famous Spirit of St. Louis took off westward, eastward, and flew across the big pond with Lindy at the controls in his leather helmet and goggles, hoping to sight the doves of peace. But he did not, even though he circled Versailles. And then the famous Yankee Clipper took off in the opposite direction and flew across the terrific Pacific. But the Pacific doves were frighted by this strange amphibious bird and hid in the Orient sky. And then the famous Flying Fortress took off, bristling with guns and testosterone, to make the world safe for peace and capitalism. But the birds of peace were nowhere to be found before or after Hiroshima. And so then clever men built bigger and faster flying machines. And these great man-made birds with jet plumage flew higher than any real birds and seemed about to fly into the sun and melt their wings. Crash to earth. And the Wright brothers were long forgotten in the high-flying bombers that now began to visit their blessings on various third worlds, all the while claiming they were searching for doves of peace. And they kept flying and flying and flying until they flew right into the 21st century. And then one fine day, a third world struck back and stormed the great plains and flew them straight into the beating heart of skyscraper America, where there were no aviaries and no parliaments of doves. And in a blinding flash, America became a part of the scorched earth of the world. And a wind of ashes blew across the land. And for one long moment in eternity, there was chaos and despair. And buried loves and voices, cries and whispers, fill the air everywhere. Cries of animals dying. In a dream within a dream, I dreamt a dream of all the animals dying out, all animals everywhere, dying and dying. The wild animals, the long-haired animals, winged animals, feathered animals, clawed and scaled and furry animals, rutting and dying and dying in shrinking rainforests, in piney woods and high sierras, on shrinking prairies and tumbleweed mesas, captured, beaten, starved and stunned, cornered and traded, species not meant to be nomadic, wandering rootless as man, all the animals crying out in their hidden places, slinking away and crawling away through the last wild places, through the dense underbrush, the last great thickets, beyond the mountains, crisscrossed with switchbacks, beyond the marshes, beyond the plains and fences, the west won with barbed wire machines. In the high country, in the low country, in the bayous, crisscrossed with highways. In a dream, within a dream, I dreamt a dream. I dreamt a dream of how they feed and rut and run and hide. How the seals are beaten on ice fields. The soft, white, furry seals with eggshell skulls. The great green turtles beaten and eaten. Exotic birds netted and caged and tethered. Rare wild beasts and strange reptiles and weird woozoos hunted down for zoos by bearded black marketeers who afterwards ride around Singapore in German limousines with French whores. I dreamt a dream of all the earth drying up to a burnt cinder in the famous greenhouse effect under a canopy of carbon dioxide breathed out by a billion infernal combustion engines mixed with the sweet smell of burning flesh. And all the animals calling to each other in codes we never understand. The seal and the steer cry out in the same voice, the same cry. The wounds never heal in the commonweal of animals. We steal their lives to feed our own, and with their lives our dreams are sown. In a dream within a dream, I dreamt a dream of the daily scrimmage for existence. In the wind-up model of the universe, the spinning meat wheel world about to consume itself. And in a dream within a dream, I saw how consumer culture eats earth and man and bottom-line capitalism, masquerading as democracy, rapes earth and man. And in a dream, I dreamt a dream of how all the watershed people of the earth, all the ethnic peoples of the earth, all the disenfranchised people of the world, the mom and pop people of America, the youth of America, and the poor of America would at last perhaps rise up and dismantle industrial civilization without killing anybody and save mankind from itself. A casino culture. It's Autogeddon, an Armageddon of autos. In the City of Angels in downtown Denver, Chicago, and Manhattan, drowned in the bad breath of machines, the sun's wearing shades, the ozone layer coughing smog, the ecosystem, a computer about to crash, a casino culture out of control, a hole in its ozone soul, a sweepstakes winner take all, a shooting gallery for masters of war, a bull market with toreadors, a runaway juggernaut heading for naught, a runaway robot bombing through cities, the hydraulic brakes blown, and no one can slow it down. Not even the president, not even the UN, not even the EU, not even the Pope, or you name it. America, America, oh, beautiful with spacious skies. In Las Vegas, they've made a replica of it. The whole tamale, the whole shebang, the Eiffel Tower, the Statue of Liberty, the George Washington Bridge, the Golden Gate. King Kong and the Empire State. Swept with Khan, the millions stand under the signs. Internet gamblers and dot-com billionaires, coked up in stretch limos. Everybody playing the slots. The predatory ladies purr, the pinballs whirr. The whole spinning world lights up. Tilt. A billion jackpots blow with a bang. Kingfishers catch fire. Dragonflies draw flame. Shoppers carried by escalators into the flames. Skin-deep civilization gone in a flash of samsara. Rock-a-bye, baby. Swing low, sweet chariot. Are there not still fireflies? But are there not still fireflies in America? Are there not still four-leaf clovers? Is not our land still beautiful? Are fields not full of armed enemies? Our cities never bombed to oblivion by foreign invaders. Never occupied by iron armies speaking iron tongues. Still valiant, ready to defend us? Are not our senators still wearing fine togas? Are we not still a great people in the greatest country in all the world? Still fireflies. Is this not still a free country? Are not our fields still ours? Our gardens still full of flowers? Our ships with full cargoes? Are are there not still fireflies? Why then do some still fear the barbarians are coming, coming, coming in their huddled masses? What is that sound that fills the air, drumming, drumming? Drumming, drumming. Is not Rome still Rome? Is not Los Angeles still Los Angeles? Are these really the last days of the Roman Empire? Still fireflies? Is not beauty still beauty? And truth still truth? Are there not still fireflies? Are there not still poets? Are there not still lovers? Are there not still mothers, sisters, and brothers? Not still a full moon once a month? Are there not still fireflies? Are there not still stars at night? Can we not still see them in bowl of night, signaling to us our manifest destinies? Since I have time, I'm going to read an unpublished poem as a sort of a denouement for the evening. The Dog in the White House. I've been living here 6 years already. If you call it living, talk about being cooped up. It's a real weird scene in here. Let me tell you, you can't lift a leg without somebody giving you the boot. You can't go sniffing around here either, in case you're hoping to dig up some buried bones. No, sir, Buried bones is something my boss don't want dug up. And when they play the national anthem, I'm not supposed to howl. And I can't start barking in the rose garden either. There ain't no fresh air out there. My boss give a lot of speeches out there to the press corps and assorted bootlickers. And I'm telling you, it's no place for a self-respecting citizen like me. I got me dog tags, just like the soldiers wear, so they can tell who's who whenever they get shipped home in a box. And my boss hung some kind of holy cross round my neck to ward off fleas, I guess. But it don't work. I'm telling you, it's a dog's life around here. My boss don't tolerate no uppity dogs. So I try to conform and even lick his shoe now and then, just like everybody else. Monkey see, monkey do. And I do have some status around here. I'm officially a guard dog, always on the alert to sniff out some terrorist in the woodpile. I know a terrorist when I smell one. You better believe me, because I smelled a lot of them in here. Let me tell you, baby, I gotta come clean with the American people. Even when I'm licking his boot, my boss totally terrifies me.
Thanks for listening. 92nd Street Y Online Media is made possible by the generous support of listeners like you. For more audio and video programs and information about our wide array of upcoming events, please visit 92y.org. This program is copyright 2007 by the 92nd Street Y.